Recorded Books Inspirational presents an unabridged recording of 16 Brides by Stephanie Grace Whitson, narrated by Ruth Ann Phimister, and directed by Stephen Mosbleck. This book is copyrighted 2010 by Stephanie Grace Whitson. This recording is copyrighted 2010 by Recorded Books, producer and publisher of Recorded Books Inspirational, an imprint dedicated to stories of faith and the human spirit. And now, 16 Brides.
From the local newspaper. Attractive Widows. April 7, 1871. Another cargo of war widows arrived in Plum Grove last Tuesday morning, 16 in number, and filed upon claims adjacent to town. This was decidedly the best lot of widows that has arrived thus far. Chapter 1. From Proverbs, chapter 16, verse 9. A man's heart deviseth his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. As the carriage pulled away from Union Station, Caroline Jameson almost panicked and called out to the driver, "Wait, don't go. I've changed my mind. Take me home." Her heart racing, Caroline forced herself to turn away. St. Louis isn't home, and home doesn't want you. Daddy told you that in his last letter. Still, there were times when she entertained a desperate few minutes of hope. But what if I was standing right there on the veranda? Would he really turn me away? If I told him I was sorry, that he was right, if I begged, what then? For just a moment, the possibility that her father might forget everything and pull her into his arms made Caroline feel almost dizzy with joy. But then she remembered. It had been 5 years since she'd opened that last envelope, and still she could recite the terse few lines of the last letter posted from General Harlan Sanford of Mulberry Plantation. "Daughter, we received word today. Langdon now joins his two brothers in glory. Your mother has taken to her bed. The idea that any or all of these deeds of war may have been committed by one their sister calls husband." The sentence wasn't finished. Caroline still remembered touching the spot where the ink trailed off toward the edge of the paper, a meandering line that wrenched her heart as she pictured Daddy seated at his desk, suddenly overcome by such a deep emotion he couldn't control his own hand. "We are bereft of children now. May God have mercy on your soul." For a moment, as Caroline stood, frozen motionless by uncertainty here on the brick walkway leading up to Union Station, desperate regret and a renewed sense of just how completely alone she was rose up. Panic nearly swept her away. If she didn't get hold of herself, she was going to faint. A few deep breaths would be helpful, but the corset ensuring her 18-inch waist wasn't going to allow for that. She closed her eyes in a vain attempt to hold back the tears. "You don't dare go home, and you don't dare stay here." An axle in need of grease squealed as another carriage pulled up to the curb, this one drawn by a perfectly matched team of black geldings. Their coats glistening, their manes plated with red ribbons, the horses tossed their heads and stamped their great hooves. As the driver called out to calm the team, a coachman hopped down from his perch, but he was too late to open the door for his fare. One glimpse of the wild-looking man emerging from the polished carriage, and Caroline swiped at her tears, snapped open her gold silk parasol, and bent down to pick up her black traveling case. "You'll make a scene if you faint right now, and the ladies of Mulberry Plantation never make a scene." The ladies of Mulberry Plantation didn't associate with the kind of men emerging from that carriage, either. Lifting her chin, Caroline headed toward the station, lest one of them offer to escort her up the hill. The last thing she needed today was to have to extricate herself from the unwanted attentions of some dandy dressed up like a poor imitation of Wild Bill Hickok. Wild Bill Hickok, indeed. Grateful to be thinking about something besides home, she almost smiled at the memory of Thomas, one of the Jameson servants, and the ridiculous hat he'd sported for weeks after seeing Hickok and Buffalo Bill on stage. A hat just like the ones on the heads of the men climbing out of the newly arrived carriage. Only these men didn't look ridiculous. They looked dangerous. Caroline peered back at them from beneath the edge of her parasol, even as she made her way up the hill. The tall one had a certain appeal, if a woman liked that kind of man. Caroline did not. With every step away from the street and toward the station, her doubt and fear receded. She could do this. After all, it was the only thing that made any sense. No one was coming to rescue her. It was time she rescued herself. Painting walls and hanging pictures don't make a barn into a home, Mama. Ella Barton looked away from her own face in the mirror just long enough to catch her mother's eye. A barn is still a barn. Shaking her head, she untied the new bonnet. I'm sorry. I just can't. You were sweet to buy it, but I look ridiculous. She put the stylish bonnet back into the open bandbox sitting atop the dresser. We'll return it on the way to the station. We will not return it. Mama snatched it up and ran her hand along the upturned brim. She smoothed the nosegay of iridescent feathers just peeking out of the grosgrain ribbon that bordered the crown. It's beautiful. Did I say it wasn't? Ella turned her back on the mirror. The problem is not the hat. Gently, she extracted the bonnet from her mother's grasp and nestled it back into the box. The old one is better. It suits me. She settled the lid on the bandbox. What do I need with a new hat, anyway? I hardly think they parade the latest fashions up and down the street in Coyote, Nebraska. Maybe not, Mama said. But you can bet there will be a parade when we all arrive. Everyone says women are in short supply out west. That means you can expect a parade of bachelors coming into Coyote as soon as word gets out about the Emigration Society's arrival. Ella crossed the room to where their two traveling cases lay open on the lumpy mattress. And they will see me as I am and leave me be. Even if I were interested, which I am not, a new bonnet wouldn't change anything. She finished folding her white cotton nightgown into the case as she spoke, especially mindful of the wide border of handmade lace as she closed the lid. It had taken her over 30 hours to make that gown. She wanted it to last. Mama joined her by the bed, closing and locking her own traveling case as she said, You don't know what others see when they look at you, Ella. You have lovely eyes. Ella snorted in disbelief. I know what they see. Milton reminded me almost every day. Milton. Mama spit the name out like spoiled meat. She made two fists and pummeled the air. I wish I could get my hands on him. I'd teach him. Mama. Ella's voice was weary. Mama's opinions about Milton had grown old long ago. Let him rest in peace. It's over. Except that it isn't. What he did to you, what he made you feel about yourself, none of that is over. Ella sighed. It was no use debating Milton Barton with Mama. Mothers looked at their daughters and saw the best, which was, in Ella's case, her eyes. But mothers tended to see only the things like beautiful hazel eyes. They ignored broad shoulders and strong frames, large hands and noses. As Ella lifted her traveling case off the bed and set it on the floor so she could smooth the blanket into place, she glanced toward the mirror. She always had regretted that nose. But simple regret had evolved into something else, thanks to Milton. It was her fault he sought other beds. It was her fault he wandered. It was her fault they had no children. She wasn't pretty, she wasn't feminine, she wasn't... Stop. Stop the litany. Stop it now. Nothing good comes of it. What was it Mama always said? Forget what lies behind, press on to hope. She must do that now. Even if she did still hear Milton's voice at times. She was clumsy. She lumbered like a cow. Such a big nose, such large hands, such rough skin. She was barren. But of all the words Milton flung at her, the ones that hurt most were the ones Ella added to the list herself. She was gullible. Gullible and stupid to have believed a man could love a woman like her. And so, after being widowed by the war, having lost her farm and much of herself in the process, Ella moved to town and rented a nondescript room on a nondescript street in St. Louis. She cooked and cleaned at a nice hotel nearby and kept to herself. She was never asked to stay on, never promoted to serve in the dining room. After all, who would want a cow lumbering about with their fancy china and silver candlesticks? Dark thoughts hung over the widow Barton like a cloud. And then one day she saw Mr. Hamilton Drake's sign in a milliner's shop window. Wanted, it said in large letters. Only women need apply. Smaller print said that Mr. Hamilton Drake of Dawson County, Nebraska, the organizer of the Ladies' Emigration Society, was here in St. Louis to help women take control of their own destiny by acquiring land in their own name. He invited all interested ladies to meet with him in Parlor A of the Laclede Hotel on any one of three evenings listed. He promised that if women would hurry, they could still acquire free prime homesteads in the most desirable portions of the county. Control of her own destiny. Land in her own name. A prime homestead. Ella stood looking at that sign for a long while. At the first meeting she attended, Mr. Drake produced an official copy of the homestead law President Lincoln had signed back in 1862. Ella read it and learned that what Drake said was right. As a single woman, and therefore the head of her own household, Ella could file on a homestead. And Ella knew land. She knew livestock and crops and plows. She knew when to plant and how to harvest. She also knew there was little, if any, chance a man would ever love her. And even if some fool tried, how would she ever know if it was sincere? But Ella knew something else, too. For the first time in a very long while, Ella knew hope. Ella looked into the mirror and smiled. Mama was right. The simply dressed woman with the plain face did have rather nice eyes. She glanced at Mama in the mirror. Dear Mama, with her tiny waist and petite stature. Mama, with her lively sense of humor and youthful spirit. What, Ella thought, would she have ever done without Mama? Ella, Mama patted her shoulder. Stop riding the clouds and come back to Earth. When Ella blinked and looked at her, Mama put her hand atop the bandbox. I asked if you're sure about the new hat. I'm sure. Ella reached for the old brown one hanging on a hook by the door. With a dramatic sigh, Mama took the bandbox in hand and opened the door. Ella picked up their two suitcases and followed her out into the hall and downstairs. As they headed toward the train station by way of the milliners, neither woman looked back. The resolve that had propelled Caroline Jameson up the hill and into Union Station faded the instant she lowered her parasol just inside the door. She hesitated, gazing at the scores of people buying tickets, hurrying toward the tracks, seated in the lunchroom, sipping tea, browsing at the newsstand. Her head hurt. Her kid leather gloves were growing damp. Perspiration trickled down her back. She was feeling shaky again. The members of the Ladies' Emigration Society were supposed to proceed through the station and gather on the siding near track number 2. Mr. Drake had said he expected almost a train car full of women to join the society. Caroline wasn't ready to meet all those strangers. She looked toward the tracks. Oh, no. Please, no. Not the sisters. Caroline had especially hoped those four would have talked each other out of heading west. At the thought of facing those four, and maybe a few dozen women just like them, Caroline found an empty bench and sat down. Pulling her traveling case onto her lap, she clung to the handle with one hand and her parasol with the other, even as she tried to calm herself. Close your eyes. Think of something else. Think about the rose garden. Remember how wonderful those yellow ones on the arbor smelled when they bloomed? Can you hear old James humming to himself while he trimmed the hedge? Shutting out the sounds of the bustling train station and thinking about the garden helped. She stopped trembling. There now. That's better. She looked toward the tracks. Where were the dozens of women Mr. Drake talked about? What if the sisters decided they wouldn't have her today? What if they united the others against her and spoke to Mr. Drake and talked him into canceling her membership in the society? Laws a massy. What if she had to go back? Back to Basil's parents' home here in St. Louis, back to... With a little shudder, Caroline stood up. When all else failed, thinking about Basil's father would give her the determination she needed for this day and 100 more like it. It had cost her everything when she ran off and married a Yankee. Those women had no idea. Had any of them spent their widowhood listening to a rattling doorknob and the mutterings of their very own father-in-law, begging them to move a trunk away from the door? Using her parasol as a walking stick, Caroline stood back up. She had as much right as anyone to homestead land. Abraham Lincoln himself had said so. May the good Lord rest his soul. A gangly blonde-haired boy, just now coming out of the diner, looked Caroline's way, nodded, and tipped his cap. She smiled at him. He blushed and hurried to where a woman dressed in a black traveling suit waited just inside the door. The woman glared at Caroline, said something to the boy, and literally pulled him toward the tracks and the group of women waiting near track number 2. Oh dear. She'd apparently just offended another member of the society, and this time she hadn't even opened her mouth. All right. The only way to do this was to just go and do it, never mind the rest of them. With one last glance toward the street, Caroline headed for the tracks. You going west too? Caroline looked back toward the owner of the gravelly voice. She couldn't possibly be old enough to file on a homestead, could she? Mr. Drake said you had to be 21. This girl didn't look a day past 18. Surely she wasn't widowed either. But then, being a widow wasn't exactly a requirement for joining the society. Some of the ladies at her meeting had appeared to be more interested in finding husbands than homesteads. Maybe that was the case with this girl. Caroline didn't know hair that color existed in nature. It reminded her of the scarlet crepe myrtle growing around the gazebo at home in Tennessee. And that dress. It was a bad enough shade of yellow now. It would have been an absolute horror before it faded. Women with hair that shade of red should never wear that yellow. Especially if they had ivory skin, it made them look ill. The girl coughed into the handkerchief she held balled up in one palm. Sorry, she said, and coughed again before extending a hand in greeting. I'm Sally, Sally Grant. No relation to the general by that name, although I got his autograph at the sanitary fair when I was little, and he said my eyes reminded him of his daughter. She rattled on as Caroline introduced herself and shook hands, but then the girl broke off abruptly. Sorry, she said. I tend to talk too much when I'm nervous. She pointed toward the group of women waiting outside. You with them? Us, I guess I should say. Caroline nodded. You as scared as I am? When the young woman coughed again, Caroline wondered if Sally Grant's pale complexion was more a result of ill health than anything else. How frightening it would be to have committed to something like this trip west and then be threatened with illness. That would be worse than a dozen attacks of nerves. The girl misinterpreted Caroline's silence. I can see you're a real lady, she said, motioning to Caroline's dark gold traveling suit and parasol, even as she made a vain attempt to smooth the front of her wrinkled calico dress. She gave a little shrug. You don't have to talk to me if you don't want to. I was just trying to be friendly. And with that, she brushed past Caroline and headed for the tracks. Wait! When the girl turned back, Caroline hurried to catch up. I'm sorry. I seem to have been rendered speechless this morning, but it's got nothing to do with you. Her voice wavered. I didn't mean to be rude. It's just that I'm... Scared? Sally Grant's smile revealed a missing front tooth. Caroline shook her head. No, ma'am. I'm not scared. I'm terrified. Only it sounded more like, I'm not scared, I'm terrified. She glanced away, hating the knowledge that she was blushing, trying to cogitate on how she would handle it if Sally Grant, frayed dress, missing tooth and all, was a certain kind of Yankee. Memphis or Nashville? Sally asked, eyeing Caroline closely. Caroline stiffened. What did that matter? She was just as deserving as any other member of the emigration society. She'd sacrificed her way of life and her own family to marry Basil, and he'd died for the Union just as surely as if he'd been shot in battle. And hadn't she herself done her duty too, nursing him faithfully until the day his body followed where his spirit had already flown? Caroline didn't even try to sound less Southern as she drawled, "What's it matter? I'm the widow of Private Basil Richard Jameson of the 9th Missouri Volunteers." Sally's blue eyes stayed friendly. She nodded. "That's so. Well, it don't really matter whether it's Memphis or Nashville. I was just wondering."
I see."
Caroline cleared her throat. She nodded toward the waiting group of women.
"You know any of them?"
Sally shook her head. "Nah. I only went to the one meeting, and they wasn't much for chit-chat, seeing as how I'm..." She bit her lower lip. Her bony shoulders lifted in a shrug. "Seeing as how I'm me, and divorced, and I told them so." She tilted her head and eyed Caroline carefully. "What about you?"
"Me? Oh, no. Like I told you, my husband was..."
"No," Sally interrupted. "Not are you divorced. I heard what you said about all that." She frowned as she pointed toward the tracks. "Seems like Mr. Drake said there'd be more of us. Do you know any of them?" Caroline shook her head.
"Those four off to the side were at the meeting when I joined, but I don't recognize any of the others."
She shrugged.
"Of course, they weren't much for chit-chatting with me. Least not after I opened my mouth and let the Tennessee out."
The girl grinned. "What do you say, you and me stick together for the ride out?" Caroline had never met anyone as forthcoming as Sally Grant. Her dress was frayed, and her thin hands and bony shoulders were evidence she probably hadn't been eating very well of late. There was a good chance that everything Sally Grant owned was inside the worn carpet bag clutched in her hands. And Caroline liked her.
"If y'all don't mind traveling with a Southern gal, I think that'd be fine."
"Well," Sally teased, mimicking the accent, "not only do I not mind, I'd be honored." And with that, she looped a thin arm through Caroline's. A gaggle of ladies, one boy, and a man who seemed to be shepherding them all made their way toward the train sitting on track number 2. As she watched them climb aboard, Hetty Gates wondered where they were headed and why. At the sound of footsteps, she whirled around, her heart racing. "Calm down." Another half dozen chattering ladies scurried through the station and followed the group boarding the train. Hetty watched them for a moment, wondering if those four always dressed alike. They were obviously sisters, maybe one pair of twins. But for them all, well, it was just odd. Glancing back toward the street, Hetty adjusted the veil attached to her hat and went to the ticket window.
"And how may I help you, ma'am?"
The agent nodded toward the train.
"Assuming, of course, that you aren't one of Mr. Drake's ladies. If you are, he's already purchased your ticket."
Beg your pardon?
"You aren't with the land agent who's been collecting ladies for Nebraska?"
Hetty frowned.
"Nebraska?"
The agent removed his spectacles and wiped them with a cloth as he said,
"Well, I'm glad to hear it."
He shook his head.
"If you ask me, Mr. Hamilton Drake's got something else in mind besides helping women get their own homesteads."
Hetty peered at him.
Can they do that? Homestead, I mean? without a man?
Well, now,
the agent said as he settled his glasses back on his nose,
that's just the thing, isn't it? How on earth could they? Can a woman plow? Can a woman grow crops? Can a woman defend herself?
The ticket agent shook his head again.
It wasn't but 3 years ago the Cheyenne derailed a handcar out that way and...
He broke off, clucked his tongue.
I don't know what this world is coming to when women begin to think they can just step into a man's world like it was nothing. But I beg your pardon for my sermonizing, ma'am. What can I do for you this fine day?
Hetty glanced at the train and then back at the agent.
California, she blurted out.
California was as good a place as any, wasn't it? Or Denver. Denver might be far enough. She could stop in and visit Aunt Cora. No, that wouldn't be wise. Aunt Cora was a lovely woman, but she never had been able to keep a confidence.
That's it right there,
the ticket agent said, and pointed at the same train the group of ladies had just boarded. He peered at Hetty over pince-nez glasses.
One way or round trip?
I don't know about the return trip. The date, I mean. I might be gone along.
One way, then, the man said. That'll be $6.
Hetty counted out her money. 6 greenbacks. Only 2 left. That was all right. She'd get a job washing dishes, maybe cleaning houses, something. A whistle blew. Snatching the ticket, she grabbed her carpet bag from where she'd set it at her feet and ran for the train. It started to move. When she tossed the bag up, it landed with a thud just outside the door to the ladies' car. Grasping the railing, she hauled herself aboard. As the train picked up speed, she struggled to catch her breath. Finally, she climbed the 3 steps to the car door. Just as she opened it and stepped through, the train lurched. If the stern-faced-looking woman in the seat on the left hadn't ducked, she would have gotten Hetty's elbow in her ear.
Excuse me,
she gasped, and dropped into the empty seat on her right, across from a petite elderly woman and a near giantess. She'd barely regained her composure when the elderly woman spoke up.
Well, so now we are 16.
16?
The woman nodded.
Yes, I agree. Disappointing.
Mr. Drake reserved the entire car. She gestured toward the empty benches at the back, then smiled.
But I don't suppose anyone will complain about having an entire double berth to themselves when it comes time to pull down the shades and go to sleep tonight.
Hetty glanced across the aisle. The woman she'd almost hit in the head had turned her back to them and was rummaging in a bag on the bench between her and a blonde-haired boy looking out the window. The bench facing them was empty. As the train picked up speed, Hetty smoothed her frizzy blonde hair and adjusted her hat. The old woman smiled. Zita Romano. She nodded at the woman seated beside her.
And my daughter, Ella.
She hesitated, obviously waiting for Hetty to introduce herself.
I'm Hetty. Hetty Ga-
She broke off. Didn't the Bible say something about shaking the dust off your feet and not looking back? She cleared her throat as she pushed her spectacles up on her nose.
Please call me Hetty.
If they didn't care about last names, so much the better. It would give her time to think of a new one. Chapter 2
From Psalm 34, verse 18. The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit. A preacher had once told Matthew Ransom that demons were meant to be cast out of a man's life, never to return, and that the power of the blood of Jesus could do it. Matthew allowed that the preacher might be mostly right, but then the preacher didn't know the particulars. And in his own mind, he, Matthew Ransom of the First Nebraska, deserved the presence of demons. Whatever it might take to atone for and banish them completely, Matthew thought it had to be more than the death of one Jewish man some 1870-odd years ago. Death was the thing that had earned Matthew the demon's presence in the first place. And failing at banishing them, he'd learned to live with them as best he could. Usually they stayed in the far reaches of the life he'd built in Nebraska, which brought more peace than he felt he deserved. Once in a while, though, they sallied forth and stayed a night or two. When that happened, buried memories became nightmares, and whispers crescendoed until Matthew woke soaked with sweat, his face streaming tears, his heart pounding, his eyes open as his mind stared into the past. And this was one of those times. The girl he'd brought to the dugout a few days ago had to be awake, but she would be afraid to move. Likely he'd let out at least one of those god-awful rebel yells while the battle raged in his nightmare. Hopefully he hadn't called any names she would recognize. If he'd shouted names, the girl would likely be standing over him demanding explanations. She was getting old enough to recognize a few of those names. That was a new worry. Matthew cast an eye toward what looked like a bundle of furs near the hearth. "Lenny?" he croaked. "Lenny, you awake?" "I had a bad dream, but you don't need to be afraid." The bundle shifted slightly, and for a brief moment a flash of ivory against the buffalo robe signaled the presence of the girl huddled there. She was awake, but she was either too frightened or too angry that he'd frightened her again to roll over and engage in conversation. "All right," Matthew said. He cleared his throat. "It must have been a bad one, I guess." Reaching for his deerskin breeches, he pulled them up and over his narrow hips, feeling his way to the arranging of things before he threw back his own buffalo robe and stood. He shivered. "What do you think your old pa should wear today, Lenny? The blue shirt or the blue one?" He forced a soft laugh, but the joke fell flat, and so he pulled on the only shirt he owned without further comment, waiting until he had it buttoned, before crossing to where a battered kettle sat on the board resting atop two pegs he'd hammered into the dugout wall to construct a kitchen shelf. "I'll get water. I understand you aren't talking to me right now, but I know you're awake. You willing to grind the coffee?" He watched the mound of buffalo robe and furs, wondering what he would do if the promise of coffee didn't work. Relieved when first a hand and then a head of tangled auburn hair appeared, the girl sat up. As far as Matthew Ransom was concerned, his daughter was as beautiful wrapped in buffalo and coyote, her shoulders encased in a faded flannel nightgown, as any queen swathed in jewels and sable. His heart flip-flopped when she looked at him with her great sad eyes. "I'm sorry I yelled," he said.
You know, I'd help it if I could.
The girl sighed. Her chin trembled. And finally, Matthew got his first glimpse of the only thing that had ever proven a surefire way to send the demons back where they belonged. When Linnea Delight Ransom's azure blue eyes lighted on him, demons fled. Pure and simple. If he could have bottled the way that girl made him feel in the morning to sell as a patent medicine, he would be a wealthy man.
I just hate it, Linny said.
I said I was sorry.
Sometimes he felt like a schoolboy being sent to the corner for misbehaving. Linny looked up at him then, tears glistening in her eyes as she said,
What I hate, Pa, is whatever it is that makes you have those dreams. I hate that it happened to you, to my Pa. And I hate that it still hurts you, almost as much as you hurt over Ma's dying.
Matthew reached for the coffee pot, lest she see how very near to tears he was himself. How grateful for her gentle love, and the way it threatened to break open the burnt-out lump of coal that was his heart. For all God's failure to answer most of Matthew's prayers, at least he had done this. He had let Linny believe it was the war that caused the nightmares. Clearing his throat, Matthew said, I expect most of the boys that marched with me have similar dreams from time to time. He forced a smile. Having you come for visits helps more than anything. But it's past time when I promised to have you back at Martha's. She'll be needing you to help her serve supper to Drake's carload of ladies when they arrive. Women. What on earth would possess a bunch of widows to climb on a train and follow a stranger west to meet and marry strangers? Matthew could not imagine. The Ladies' Emigration Society, Drake called it. Matthew wondered what the women would think if they knew some had taken to calling it the Ladies' Desperation Society.
I wish you'd stay in town until the dance Friday, Linny said.
She tilted her head and smiled.
You might like it, you know. Martha says you used to like to dance. She said you and Ma...
She broke off. Matthew swallowed and nodded.
We did like to dance, he agreed. Your ma was a sight to behold. Most graceful thing I ever saw.
He hesitated, then decided to ignore the pain it would cause him to talk about Katie and give their daughter a gift only he could give. And so he forced a smile, hoping it wasn't a grimace.
Did I ever tell you about the first time I saw your ma?
The girl's expression transformed itself into something like the look Matthew had seen on the faces of soldiers standing in line for rations. Hungry, half-starved, eager. Her obvious need helped him ease past the pain and dust off the memory.
Make it shine, you sorry excuse for a father. Give her something to treasure.
Well, Matthew said, and he sat down next to her, right at the corner of the pelt that protected her against the chill of the spring morning.
The first time I saw your ma, she was waltzing with a tall, square-jawed cadet, and I was instantly jealous of that man's hand pressed against the narrowest waist I'd ever seen. Her dress shimmered like a golden sunrise, and it made her eyes look even more blue than the azure sky.
He paused, remembering the moment and realizing that he was taking joy in that memory.
Joy. It was an odd feeling.
And then what, Pa?
Matthew looked across at his daughter, and it was like looking into Katie's eyes all over again.
The pain returned, a more familiar emotion, an emotion he could embrace. He cleared his throat.
Well, she saw me. I don't know why she saw me in that crowded place. There were plenty of more handsome men.
Huh? Linny disagreed. You were the handsomest. I just know it.
Matthew chuckled. She wanted a fairy tale. He would give her one.
Well, I wasn't the ugliest anyway.
He winked.
Nor was I the tallest. That cadet she was dancing with had me by inches.
Always did. Always won the girls, too. Except for Katie. At least for a while.
Bitterness rolled in as Matthew contemplated the other cadet and Katie. Together. He caught himself clenching his hands, took a deep breath.
So I crossed that dance floor. When I got close enough, I was almost afraid to speak. I thought your mom might just evaporate, like she really was a dream. But she didn't.
He forced a smile.
And when I tapped that tall cadet on the shoulder, your ma smiled at me, like she was glad I broke in. It was bad manners to do that, but I couldn't help myself.
What did the other cadet do? Did he fight you?
Matthew shook his head.
Nope. He bowed out.
And then what?
Well, then she never danced with anybody else the whole night. Waltz after waltz belonged to me.
Linny clasped her hands with joy.
Oh, Pa!
And then the magic was gone. Her eyes filled with tears, and she threw her arms around his neck.
I wish she didn't die. I wish...
Whatever she was saying was lost to emotion. Matthew closed his eyes and held her and hardened his heart against memory lest he cry too. When next he spoke, he was in control again.
So do I. And I know about your other wishes too, and I'm trying. I really am. A couple more good trapping seasons and I'll give you a proper home again.
Linny let go and sat back, brushing the tears off her cheeks with the back of her hand. She gazed around the dugout.
I wouldn't mind living here, she said. I could make it homey.
I know you could, Matthew agreed, but I'd mind your living here. I promised myself I'd do right by you, and I will.
He stood up.
Now, get your duds on while I see to things outside. We'll have us a nice breakfast before we get back on the trail toward Plum Grove.
He'd pulled the door open when Linny called out,
Can we stop at home?
She swallowed the last sound of the word home and replaced it with another question.
Can we stop by Ma's grave?
Matthew kept his gaze on the horizon.
If you want.
Maybe you could show me where the violets are blooming, the ones you said she liked so much.
If Linny knew how the thought of Katie picking wildflowers seared through him, she'd likely never mention violets again. But she didn't know. She was just a sweet girl longing to move home and wishing her ma was still alive. Matthew nodded and stepped outside. As he headed for the spring where he'd get water to make coffee, he wondered anew how he was going to tell Linny he'd sold the homestead. The new owner would be coming into Plum Grove sometime this week. Linny probably wouldn't see the sale as anything but horrible, when in reality it was progress, at least for Matthew. He'd faced the fact that he would never be able to live in Katie's house again,
and was taking steps to move toward creating a new future for himself and their daughter. But Linny wouldn't see it that way. She'd likely be hurt and angry. Maybe Martha Haywood would help her understand.
Martha, if ever there was a living, breathing angel on this earth, it was her. Matthew shuddered to think what would have happened to Linny without that good woman agreeing to take the baby and give Matthew some time. He often wondered if Martha would still have said yes had she known that some time would turn into years. Had she known, she'd end up doing the better part of raising Katie's only living child. Something told Matthew it wouldn't have mattered. Every time he screamed at heaven that he just didn't believe there was anyone up there listening, anyone who cared, it was as if something whispered, "Martha Haywood," back to him as proof he was wrong. His coffee pot filled, Matthew returned to the dugout. As he opened the door, the aroma of ham frying made his mouth water. Linny was standing at the stove, her back to the door. When she turned toward him, something in the way she held the meat fork reminded him of Katie. His heart lurched, and the demons danced. Ruth Dow looked up from her book to where Jackson lay sprawled across the empty seat opposite them, his rolled-up jacket for a pillow. He'd been reading the book he'd purchased at Union Station, but now he was staring at her with sad brown eyes. "Do you think Aunt Margaret will ever come and visit?" he asked.
"Did she say anything about visiting when you said goodbye this morning?" Jackson sat up. With a shake of his head, he closed the book and laid it next to him.
"No, but,"
he shrugged,
"it might be nice if she did someday."
Ruth waved him over to sit beside her and, looping her arm through his, said, "Once we're settled in our own home, I'll write." She forced a chuckle. "After all, they say that absence makes the heart grow fonder." Of course, unless absence was a force for miracle working, the chances the two sisters would ever so much as speak again were slim. But 14-year-old Jackson didn't need to know that.
"If she won't come to Nebraska, can I go back to St. Louis sometime and visit?"
"Good heavens, Jackson, we're barely out of the city. It's a bit early to be planning a visit, don't you think?"
"I don't see why we had to leave in the first place."
"I told you why. Margaret and Theo needed the room, and it's time we made our own way in the world."
"And while your father's legacy is rich in character, he left us destitute."
Ruth pointed at the book he'd left on the bench. "Is it good?" Jackson shrugged.
"You wouldn't like it."
Ruth reached over and picked it up. "Texan Joe or Life on the Prairie." A dime novel. Not exactly the kind of reading material a general's son should... Ruth caught herself. "You were going to turn over a new leaf, remember? Positive thoughts, positive words."
"Perhaps you'll learn something useful."
She made a point of looking out the window. "Do you remember how far Mr. Drake said it was to the first station on the route? You might be thinking on what you'd like to eat." She handed Texan Joe back. Thankfully, Jackson dropped the subject of his Aunt Margaret and returned to his book. Looking at her son's profile, Ruth realized that the older Jackson got, the more he looked like his father. Unable to get her mind back into her own book, she pondered Jackson's bright future. He was George Washington Jackson Dow II, And someday, thanks to what his mother was doing right now, he would stride across a dais somewhere and receive a university diploma. It was a plan that would make the general proud, and Ruth was going to see to it. In 5 years, she would prove up and sell her homestead at a profit. The money would enable her and Jackson to move wherever he wished to seek his degree, and she would keep house for him, taking in sewing to make ends meet. As the train sputtered and clacked its way west, Ruth gazed out the window. The trees in this part of Missouri were beginning to leaf out. Mr. Drake said that tree planting was one of the first things most settlers in Nebraska did. He'd warned them not to expect trees. Ruth couldn't quite imagine a landscape without trees. They would plant oaks. She would have flower beds on either side of her front door. Perhaps she'd transplant some wildflowers at first. A trellis would be nice, too, with roses, red ones. She would have to remember to ask Mr. Drake which merchant in Coyote stocked the very best rose bushes. Some might see such a purchase as excess, but a woman needed beauty. Fear nudged its way into her plans. What if the homesteads near town are already claimed? What if you have to live far out on the prairie alone, just you and Jackson? What if... The familiar knot returned to her stomach. She gazed about the car. No one had taken the initiative to begin any conversations at the station, and Mr. Drake had disappeared as soon as the train began to move, promising to return soon and make introductions. She'd overheard the names of the ladies across the aisle. Zita, Ella, Hetty. For the most part, though, everyone was keeping to themselves. Zita, Ella, Hetty, the four sisters, double chin and rotund, redhead and rebel. Ruth took each woman's measure, feeling somewhat dismayed by the excess of calico and bonnets. Only three of the ladies wore silk, and Ruth was the only one dressed in mourning. And those sisters. Plaid might be fashionable this year, but really, one needn't use up an entire bolt. Plaid dresses and bows and cuffs and collars. They must be very close sisters to have planned coordinating traveling ensembles. What would that be like, she wondered. What if I could take it all back? Apologize. Accept Margaret's advice. Avoid that awful scene. What if... Sighing, Ruth leaned her head back and closed her eyes. She could still see the fine lines around Margaret's mouth deepen as she pursed her lips with displeasure at Ruth's refusal to see things her older sister's way. It wasn't the first time they'd spouted angry words at one another, but it proved to be the last. Cecil Grissom will make you a good husband and Jackson a good father. I disagree, Ruth protested. He's insufferably strict. He's firm. And if you ask me, Jackson needs a firm hand. You don't even try to discipline him. He's spoiled rotten and you know it. Well, I didn't ask. And since when are you the family expert on child-rearing? The instant the words were out, Ruth wished she could draw them back. Her voice faltered. I'm sorry, Margaret, I shouldn't have said that. It was unkind. But there's more to it than the way Cecil and Jackson get along. The general was my soulmate. I loved him with all my heart and... She took a deep breath. I can't just decide to move on. It isn't that simple. I didn't say it was simple. But it's been 4 years, Ruth, and you still dress in full mourning.
Couldn't you at least try to encourage Cecil?
Ruth stamped her foot and snapped, I am not going to marry Cecil Grissom.
Fine. After a brief moment, Margaret sighed. When she continued, her voice was calm. Calm and dismissive. Her hand went to her midsection.
I didn't want to tell you this way, but the fact is, I'm about to gain some experience in child rearing. We'll be needing your rooms. Jackson's for the nurse Theo wants to hire, and yours...
Margaret's expression softened. Yours for the baby. Ruth's stammered congratulations fell flat, as did her apology. And suddenly one season of her life was over, and she was forced unwillingly into another. Where to live now? How to provide for Jackson? She'd saved so much by living with Theo and Margaret, but not nearly enough. What to do? And then she saw a flyer at the milliner's and discovered an answer that would require only 5 years instead of a life sentence of marriage to a man she merely liked. As the train rumbled and the car rocked, Ruth's thoughts cycled back to her list of what-ifs, and once again her stomach roiled.
Oh, God, please, God, I know I haven't said much to you these past years.
She broke off. God hadn't listened when she asked him to keep the general safe. Why would he listen today? With a sigh, Ruth gazed out the window at the greening countryside. It was up to her now. Everything was up to her. Chapter 3. From Psalm 118, verse 8. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. The train had belched and clacked its way halfway across Missouri before Caroline looked up from her worn copy of Jane Eyre and noticed that Sally Grant, her once pale cheeks bright red, was leaning against the window, hugging herself as if she were cold.
You feeling poorly?
Caroline closed the book and laid it aside. Sally didn't even open her eyes.
I'll be all right, she murmured. I'm just real tired.
She coughed into the handkerchief she held, wadded up in one bare hand.
Didn't sleep worth anything last night. Too nervous.
Let me see the conductor about getting you a blanket, Caroline said.
She glanced behind them. A few passengers had come aboard since St. Louis, but there were still empty seats.
We could fold out a berth if you'd like. You might as well stretch out.
You don't gotta go to any trouble on my account, Sally murmured.
It's no trouble. I'm glad to have something to do besides reading. In fact, once you're settled, how about if I fetch some tea?
Only first class is allowed in the dining car, Sally said. Mr. Drake said so.
Where on earth was Mr. Drake anyway? Caroline wondered. For all his talk about seeing to their every need and facilitating introductions on the train, he hadn't shown his face since St. Louis. She smiled at Sally.
They'll make an exception for a lady.
Reaching for her shawl, she headed up the aisle. No rule had been made that a gentleman wouldn't break for a determined Southern belle. Caroline peered through the dining car door window to where Hamilton Drake lounged, his back to the door.
It was annoying enough to discover the man had apparently bought himself a first-class ticket at the expense of the Emigration Society. But she felt a great deal more than annoyance when she saw whom Drake was lounging with. The stranger didn't look any less threatening without the wide-brimmed black hat he'd had on when he descended from that carriage at Union Station this morning. Cool gray eyes, chiseled features, broad shoulders, and something about the mouth. Cruelty? No, not that. Something more familiar. An expectant, self-assured smile that somehow rankled. When he nodded at Caroline and then spoke to Mr. Drake, the latter turned around and, laying a napkin atop the table, hurried to greet her. The gray-eyed stranger and his two traveling companions stood up, too.
"Don't tell me this is one of your ladies, Drake," he said, his gaze never leaving Caroline's.
Caroline looked away from the stranger to smile at the approaching waiter. "Now, I know my place, and it's not in the first-class dining car, but I am sincerely hoping y'all will make an exception and make some tea for a passenger, a friend of mine who is feeling a mite poorly." The stranger's gaze followed the contours of Caroline's body as he spoke.
"It's obvious you are first class in every way that matters."
He smiled at the waiter.
"And I'm certain George here will agree and fetch you anything you request."
The waiter gave a little bow.
"Lemon and honey as well, ma'am?"
"How kind of you to offer. Yes, please." With another little bow, the waiter retreated toward the small kitchen at the opposite end of the dining car. When the gray-eyed stranger pulled out an empty chair so that Caroline could be seated, she remained standing. Looking Mr. Drake's way, she purred a gentle scolding. "We all been wondering where you were. Dare I hope you'll agree to escort me back to the emigrant car?"
"Watch out, Drake," the stranger chuckled. "When a belle's voice sounds like molasses, she's got you in her crosshairs. Careful she doesn't take aim and shoot."
He snatched Drake's hat off the hook on the wall above their table and handed it over.
"You'd best do whatever the lady wants. We can talk another time."
Once again, he looked Caroline up and down, slowly.
"Since Drake here seems to have forgotten his manners," he said, "allow me to introduce myself, Lucas Gray."
He indicated the other two men standing beside him.
"These boys are two of my ranch hands, Johnny True and Lowell Day. I make them travel with me so I can keep an eye on them."
He winked. The man's air of familiarity was unconscionable. She was itching to slap the leer right off his face. Why didn't Drake speak up? "Why don't you just handle it yourself?"
"Mama would. Mama could glide through social muck and remain untouched."
Caroline had once seen her defuse a situation likely to end in a duel without batting an eye.
If Mama could do all that, surely Caroline could resist the temptation to slap a stranger who didn't have the sense to stop staring at her that way.
But land sakes, were all Westerners this rude? The waiter arrived with a basket into which he'd nestled a sturdy white teapot alongside slices of lemon, a delicate teacup and saucer, and a sugar bowl. As Drake fumbled with the coins to pay for the tea, Caroline shone her most charming smile and thanked the waiter. "You, sir, are a very kind gentleman." With barely a nod in Lucas Gray's direction, she pretended that Drake had offered his arm and took it. She managed a triumphant retreat for a few steps, but then
she gave in to temptation. Wishing to bask in the idea that she'd handed the arrogant Mr. Lucas Gray a gentle but undeniable social defeat, she glanced back as she and Drake exited the car. Expecting to see the rancher sitting back down, hoping perhaps that his two ranch hands were taking pleasure in seeing their boss put in his place, Caroline was disappointed. Lucas Gray was watching her. When she met his gaze, he didn't bow. Instead, he smiled and winked. Again. Oh, dear. Feeling her cheeks warmed by a blush, Caroline looked away. She could almost see Mama shaking her head in disappointment. In games of cat and mouse, there must be no doubt to either party as to which player has the claws. Using those claws, however, is always a lady's last resort. As she followed Mr. Drake toward the emigrant car, Caroline flexed her right hand, embarrassed by the knowledge that in this most recent game, she hadn't been the player with the claws. She'd been the prey. When the Southerner returned to the emigrant car with a tea basket-toting Hamilton Drake, Ruth couldn't help but smile to herself. Leave it to a Southern belle to get her way, enlist a man's assistance, and transform him from absentee to solicitous escort in the process. Why, Drake actually sat down next to Rebel and Redhead and helped with the pouring and preparing of the tea. It was a wonder what a tiny waist and a winsome smile could accomplish. A few minutes later, as the train began to slow for the next stop, Drake made a little speech about how the Ladies' Emigration Society was pleased to invite them all to dine together at the society's expense. He begged their pardon for absenting himself for the first part of the journey and assured them that he had been detained by business of the utmost importance to the society's membership. Had Hamilton Drake always been this pompous? Had her own sense of desperation made her overlook all the little things about the man that set Ruth's nerves on edge now? For the first time, she noticed that he never quite looked any of them in the eye. He had a nervous habit of smoothing his beard when he spoke. And that pose, one hand on the back of a seat, the other in a loose fist poised at his waist at just the right angle, as if he were the subject of an artist's portrait. Why hadn't she noticed these things before? Ruth wondered. But then the train screeched to a halt, and amidst the flurry of activity, Jackson bounded off the train ahead of her, and Ruth forgot her concern for anything else as she hurried to catch up to him. Clearly, Jackson had not listened to a thing his mother had told him about speaking with strangers, for by the time she got inside the station, he was engaged in conversation with a tall stranger wearing a cowboy hat and sporting a Western-style holster and a gun. Jackson gave a little wave the minute he saw Ruth, but instead of coming over to her, he took the bag the candy counter attendant was holding out to him and hurried back toward the train. Ruth frowned. The broad-shouldered cowboy walked her way. Touching the brim of his hat, he introduced himself.
Lucas Gray, ma'am. Please forgive my being so forward, but the boy was in a hurry to take some lemon drops to someone. Mrs. Grant, I believe, and her friend, Mrs. Jameson. And as I've had the pleasure of making Mrs. Jameson's acquaintance and already knew Mr. Drake from Coyote, well...
He shrugged.
I told young Master Dow that I'd see to the tea he ordered for his mother.
He smiled.
From what he said, I was expecting white hair and a cane, not one of the most attractive women on the train.
He barely paused before adding, "You will allow me the pleasure of joining you, I hope." Flustered by the man's forward ways, Ruth didn't answer. Instead, she began fishing in her bag for change to pay for the tea. When Mr. Gray slipped the waiter a coin, she protested, "That isn't necessary."
"If it were necessary, it wouldn't be quite such a pleasure now, would it?"
As he was speaking, Mr. Gray was pulling one of the chairs away from a nearby table, clearly inviting her to sit down.
"Thank you," she said, "but we've a society meeting over lunch."
She turned toward the table along the far wall, where the rest of the women in the group had found places. Gray seemed not to notice her desire to end the conversation.
"Your son seems quite taken with the idea of moving west," he said. "Of course, a large part of the fascination is those dime novels boys read these days. I hope you don't mind, but I told him that if he ever wants to see how a real ranch operates, he's welcome to visit my spread. It's the largest one in Dawson County."
He did have a very nice smile.
"Of course, I told him it would all depend on whether or not his mother, and perhaps a new father by then, gave their permission."
What on earth did that mean? A new father? What an inappropriate and unduly personal comment. Ruth lifted her chin.
"Thank you for being kind to my son. I don't know that there will be time for him to go visiting for a while. There will be a long list of things for him to help me with before we think about socializing. And now if you will excuse me..."
"Of course."
Gray smiled. He touched the brim of his hat with one finger.
"I'll look forward to seeing all you ladies again on Friday."
Ruth frowned. "I beg your pardon?"
"At the dance in Coyote."
"The dance?"
"Why, yes, ma'am. You can count on there being a long line of hopefuls just waiting for the chance to charm you."
He leaned a little closer.
"Now, there's no need to be defensive about it at all. Life can be difficult for unattached ladies. No one in Dawson County thinks badly of the society members for being agreeable to Drake's idea."
"Drake's idea?"
Mr. Gray nodded. "A mutual interest in a homestead is as good a reason as any to marry. In fact, to hear him tell it, Drake expects the bride business to provide the circuit rider coming through Coyote on Sunday with the most well-attended service on record."
"Bride business? Circuit rider?"
Ruth set her teacup down on the table.
Her hand went to the frill of lace at her neck. "Yes. Well, if you will excuse me."
She hurried away.
As evening came on, first one, then another of the passengers rose and began preparations for the long night aboard the train. Folding seats out to create berths, accepting pillows and blankets from the conductor, pulling down shades and closing shutters. With Jackson stretched out nearest to the window, Ruth lay on her back, staring up at the paneled ceiling above her. The redhead's cough was worse. Sally Grant, that was her name. The southerner was Caroline Jameson. Ruth glanced across the aisle, smiling at the sight of little Zita Romano, curled up in the space left after her daughter Ella stretched out diagonally across the berth. Hetty had insisted on moving to the back of the car for the night so Ella and her mother would have more room. Ruth couldn't remember ever meeting a woman as tall as Ella Barton before. It hadn't taken but a moment over lunch to realize that she knew the most about farming of any of the members. By the time each of the 16 women around the table had introduced herself, it was time to get back on the train. Ruth hadn't had a chance to draw Mr. Drake aside and inform him of Mr. Lucas Gray's misunderstanding about the Ladies' Emigration Society. Now, as she lay in the twilight thinking about it, she wondered anew how Mr. Gray had come to associate the Ladies' Emigration Society with such poppycock as some kind of bride business. Thinking about Lucas Gray made her wonder if all the men in Dawson County sported holsters and guns. Did they wear spurs that jangled when they walked? When she scolded Jackson, mildly, about speaking with a stranger, Jackson said that meeting Lucas Gray was like having Texan Joe step out of his book. The boy's eyes shone with wonder as he talked about Mr. Gray's invitation to visit a real ranch. Ruth had to admit that her first experience with a real cowboy had been interesting. He might lack a sense of proper etiquette around ladies, but Gray exuded a certain kind of charm. Not the kind of charm she would ever find attractive, of course, but still, charm. Sadly, he did walk right along the edge of propriety in his dealings with ladies. He spoke without being properly introduced, invited himself to sit and have tea, and expounded on personal topics that any gentleman... Whatever happened to your plan to think positive thoughts? You were going to resist the habit of judging others so quickly, remember? For all your thinking of Mrs. Jameson as a rebel, hasn't she been kind to that poor Sally Grant? And they've all been wonderful to Jackson. You were going to stop being so suspicious. Hope for the best. Look toward the light. Brushing the back of her hand across her forehead, Ruth decided that perhaps she should exercise her new outlook in the matter of Mr. Lucas Gray. In fact, now that she thought about it, she wondered if he might have been having a little fun at her expense earlier today. Perhaps his mention of ordered brides and weddings and circuit riders was just another version of a tall tale. People initiated newcomers with things like that all the time. Don't forget how the men at Fort Wise welcomed new recruits. The more she thought about it, the more certain Ruth was that that was exactly what had happened between her and Lucas Gray. In fact, the rascal would probably laugh when he recounted how he'd toyed with a greenhorn. Ruth forced a chuckle of her own. If Lucas Gray thought he was going to fool General George Washington Jackson Dow's widow with wild talk about how Westerners engaged in instant weddings, he was mistaken. As for Jackson's visiting Mr. Gray's spread, that would never happen. Jackson Dow was not going on any flights of fancy about life in the West. He was going to school in Coyote, where he would study hard and graduate with perfect grades. If he got bored, he would work at the general store, or the livery, if it came to that. He liked animals, although Ruth wasn't comfortable with the inherent dangers of working around horses. Be that as it may, in 5 years, George Washington Jackson Dow II would be a freshman at Washington University in St. Louis, and this little trip into the West would be nothing more than fodder for stories to tell the general's grandchildren someday. Mail-order brides, indeed. As night came on and murmurs gave way to snores, Ruth smiled to herself. Perhaps she'd entertain someone in St. Louis with her own tall tale about cowboys and such one day. Wouldn't that be amusing? Hetty Gates had already awakened, freshened up, and returned to her temporary seat at the back of the emigrant car when the sun began to fade the indigo sky. Ella and Zita were still sleeping, and Hetty was glad. She needed time to think. Chasing after the first train leaving St. Louis and falling, very literally, into the midst of something called the Ladies' Emigration Society had opened entirely new possibilities. Dare she entertain them? She'd expected to be found out at lunch, but as it turned out, Hamilton Drake wasn't a very organized man. Hetty wasn't the only woman he didn't seem to remember from whatever meetings it was he'd held in St. Louis. And as the ladies each stood in turn and introduced themselves, Hetty was able to gather enough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.